depressed general. I didn't know I was going to meet a general today. Shoot.
What does that say?
No, either.
That doesn't happen every day.
It seems to be a running joke now, though, unfortunately. they made a huge mistake at Sundance. You guys knew each other before you started on this particular journey. Yes?
That's correct.
Yeah. Cindy, where was the first clinic you...
I first went into Pennsylvania.
Pennsylvania.
But I was just trying to live with my horse at that point.
And she rode with me first in Texas. And she and some other friends were down there with an old friend of mine from Montana, and which he'll turn up anywhere. And when I saw him, I said, Vern, what in the world are you doing down here? He said, well, I'm down with all these gals. And so that's where we sort of hit it off. And then Cindy rode with me again in Montana. And that's where she approached me with the idea of doing a documentary. And I said, sure, why not?
You know, so you're not only the horse whisperer, you're kind of the Grateful Dead of horse people? People travel around the country on tour with you?
Well,
yeah, they do.
They do follow me around quite a bit. But horsemanship is and has been one of the fine arts for a long time, thousands of years. And to really study horsemanship, to bring it to where it is an art form, it's quite a devotion. And there are people out there that is their passion in life, is to one day become a horseman.
So is that your way into this? Or do you consider being a filmmaker before all this started? Or
no, actually, I was not a filmmaker. And it's funny because this conversation that he's talking about was about a two-minute conversation. You were eating lunch at McGinnis Meadow, and I just went up because I had been thinking about it for... Well, since I'd been in the Texas clinic, and it just, there was something just kept gnawing at my heart, saying, this is, you need to get this message out. And I thought about the ways to do that. And the only way that I thought would make sense is to do a film, because I do love film. Mm-hmm. But I had been in fine art and photography and fashion, but never a film.
So was it scary to think about taking on that responsibility?
It was scary, but I've never been afraid of a challenge. It just, once I decide to do something, I do it.
Well, I don't think she acted scared, really. To me, I thought, really from the very beginning, that she had a real vision of what she wanted it to be. And she was pretty focused. And because I have a keen eye for people who just dabble at things. I have an appreciation for someone who really is focused and driven to do something. And she never lost focus the whole time. It's quite a long project, going on 3 years.
I don't know if he knew I had not made a film, because it was a very short conversation.
Well,
did you know?
You know,
I didn't tell him.
I maybe didn't know, but I wouldn't have cared. Because when I wrote The Faraway Horses, I had never authored a book before, and there were actually a few friends were sort of disparaging about that. They basically said, well, what in the hell makes you think a publisher is going to read it, let alone publish it? And I said, well, why wouldn't they? So, and sure enough, I got it published and sold 150,000 books with absolutely no promotion or marketing behind it. So if she'd have said, well, I've never done a documentary, I'd have said, well, so? That doesn't matter.
So have you ever been precious at all about the work and about how you're seen and that kind of thing? I mean, it seems like you are a very important figure in that world, one of the top figures in that world, and here you are handing somebody an opportunity to present you as such. Was that any consideration for you?
There was never a time where I thought that there was a risk that Cindy wasn't going to honor what I'm doing. That I can't say that ever occurred to me through the entire process. And that's saying something, because I've, working on The Horse Whisperer, and I've done some commercials and things over the years. You'll get people that are not really dialed into what you're really about. They're doing the best they can, but they don't really have a deep understanding of what you're doing. And you have to be very careful how they go about things, because they can easily misrepresent something it's my life, but I never had a doubt with Cindy, so.
Which I have to say really shocked me, because I thought, he doesn't know me that well. He knew Vern. But I thought, he's taken a huge leap of faith because he doesn't really know me that well. And I really, he was right. I cared 100%. I was going to make the best film I could make. Mm-hmm. But I'm from the East Coast. You don't trust anybody, you know, New Yorkers. We're kind of like, okay, what do you really want? And I would try to call him in the beginning. This is funny to me, but mm-hmm. I would try to call him to talk about my vision. Like, you know, this is what really means something. First of all, you can't get him on the phone. And when I would call him and say, well, you know, you want to talk about the film? And I'm busy. You know, 2 minutes, he's off the phone. And, you know, it's like Robert Redford in The Horse Whisperer. You're lucky to ever get him on the phone. So after a while, I just gave up. I thought, I guess he's just going to really trust me. But that meant a lot to me, too. And then it put more pressure on me in a way because I thought, this guy's really trusting me. He's a perfectionist. I know I'm a perfectionist, but he doesn't know that. And so it put more pressure that I got it right. You know, I just thought, I can't fail him now because he's trusting me so much with this story, and I better do it.
So did you, as Buck said before, know the theme really of this film before you even started? Did it really kind of become what it was naturally?
I knew that I wanted to convey what Buck gives to people in his clinics about the horses. Mm-hmm. And to me, it really was a lot about horses, but it really was so much more than that, and I knew that, and I wanted to do both, and that's where this great film team really helped to mold the story.
How so?
Well, because we would screen stuff, and we would put this story in, and mm-hmm. and then we'd be like, well, that's not really moving the story ahead. They were really helpful in the story arc and helping me build the story and get all the points in about the horses and about the feel, mm-hmm. and also about all the other levels that he brings to the table of
I think, you know? Too, Cindy was real smart in this, that she surrounded herself with people who were experts that were very, very successful at this already. It might have been a different subject matter, but they knew their deal. She got in the A-team, and it made a difference, so that then all she had to worry about was them getting the point to what her vision was for this. So it probably made it a whole lot easier for her, because then she could just deal with the substance, really, of the story.
So did you just dive in and start shooting? Was that the approach?
Yeah.
Well, pretty much. And I have to say that when we first talked about it in Montana, I thought, you know, I've been around a while, and you hear lots of things. I didn't take Nick Evans very serious when he told me he was going to write a book. And we hit it off pretty well and got to be pretty good friends. But, of course, he said, I'm going to do a novel. And I'm, of course, kind of went, well, that's real good, Nick. But imagine how many times I've heard that over the years. You know, nothing, of course, happened. I just said, well, good luck with that little book thing you're going to do, Nick. Mm-hmm. And so, in a way, when Cindy and I first talked about it, I thought, well, we'll see if she follows up. Well, and then I didn't see her for a couple of weeks. Next thing I know, I'm in Maine, and the rain is just coming down in sheets. It's horrible. And they're there. There's cameras everywhere, and away we go. So I thought, well, if they want to come out and shoot this in this kind of weather, they must be serious about what they're doing.
I find that also in the world. You know, you want to hire people, they always want a job or whatever. You go, okay, write something. And over at our job in publishing.
Right.
And you say, okay, write something, you know, write a column or whatever, and I'll take a look and probably publish it, and great. 90% of the time, never shows up.
Right.
And that's relatively easy compared to this, certainly.
Yeah.
So you went on and got a team together of yes. people. Did you know how to shoot all of this? You talked a little bit in the Q&A about how some shots were unusable because they didn't match him and the horse. Did you figure out how to shoot it as you went, or?
I did, because I was envisioning that when the cameras were shooting at him, and I thought, well, you know, they're getting this. You know, I'm used to working in that kind of format of a rectangle between art and photography, and so I just assumed they were getting it, and I would go back and look at footage. And there would be so many times when the horse's head was cut off, and just things that for me as a composition artist and also as a filmmaker, and where the horse part is so important, I'd come back and go, no, and I would just keep telling the photographers, you've got to get the horse's feet in there, you've got to get the head in there, because what he's doing is so important, but the horse people want to see what's the reaction of the horse.
Well, I think where Cindy was clever too is after a short time, for a period of time, the cameramen were trying to get me to pose and act like I was living my life. Mm-hmm. And things that I do, they're going to happen where they happen. I'm dealing with horses and people, and you can't set up shots any more than I can memorize a script to do what I do. Mm-hmm. So she got clever. There was a turning point there, and I don't know if you remember the day, but there was a turning point where she started anticipating where it was going to happen. She'd seen enough of this. Mm-hmm. So she would place the cameramen sometimes where they didn't think they needed to be, because she knew where it was going to end up. Mm-hmm. It's sort of like a real good hockey player. He plays where the puck's going to be, not where it is. Mm-hmm. And that's kind of how she started arranging things, and then it made things quite a bit easier after that, too, I think. Yeah. So.
And you could feel that from your
position. Oh, yeah,
position.
Because then I would notice, you know, where they were, and I'd think, well, they got that time. Instead of missing it.
And did you say, good on you, Cindy, and, you know, congratulations, or did she just...
Well, you know what? At the time, I left her alone to do her deal because she was compiling as much as she could, and all she needed from me was for me to be me, so I did my part.
Yeah, he was not... He wouldn't get involved and try to come over and manipulate anything. Mm-hmm. He really did what he did. And I was amazed at the access that he gave us. He would... Mm-hmm. We would show up over and over, and I thought, when is he going to just tell me to get lost? Because this has got to be getting old. But I would go back and look at things, and I would think, I know we can get that better. I know we've shot this, and be like, Buck, we're going to come back and shoot this. And he never said it, but sometimes I thought he's probably ready for us to move on and get this thing done.
Well, I really wanted it to be right. So, yeah. You know, there were times where we might do things over and over at different clinics and maybe the same situation, but a different horse and a different person. But when I'm involved in something, I want it done right, you know? So if you have to work out a little bit harder, well, then work a little harder.
So was the inclusion of your family, particularly your daughter and your history with your father, were those things that were going to, you pretty much figured would be part of this from the beginning, or were those things that you decided were okay?
Yeah, I think so. My daughter, she's so gregarious, and people really enjoy her, and she's really outgoing, and I just love to see her when she's like that, because I wasn't that way. And I just celebrate seeing her be so outgoing, you know, so this was easy for her.
And the childhood story was in his book. It wasn't like I discovered that. He had already written about it in The Faraway Horses, So people knew, and that was another thing that you would hear when we were on the road. A lot of people come up to him, a lot of people write him letters saying how much that story changed their life, because then they bonded with Buck, not on just a horse level, but on this personal level that it's not many people can just relate to that. And it meant a lot to people. And it also made you realize that he could deal with horses from a place that some people maybe couldn't, and, you know, because you're coming at them, you know what fear feels like, so you're not going to use fear to train them.
Well, it's interesting because there's another picture at the festival, Partick Nim, which is a very different take on, you know, the stories about this chimpanzee that's also very moving and very very much about humans and not about the monkey so much. You know, it's really about how we treat each other. Yeah. And that seems to be, from both of these pictures, what I think the audience seems to be getting out of that. Is that a fair assessment?
Yeah, I think so. And then the word anthropomorphism. Gee, you hear that again and again when it comes to these people, whether it's their dogs or their cats or their chimpanzees or their horses. And I just think to myself sometimes, why in the hell would you want to make your horse like you, a human being? Why would you want to do that? Because it's not like us humans have completely got our act together at this point in time. And the horse or the dog or whatever it might be, they might be just fine like they are.
Mm-hmm. Well, the boundaries of any animal, any person, it seems like that's the trick. I guess the word's not, trick is not the right word, but that you are able to do is that you're able to be empathetic to a degree where you see what they're capable of, not just what you want them to do.
True, and to be a leader. You know, you can be a leader without being intimidating. And the horse can be your partner without being your slave. And I'm trying to keep the best part of the horse in there. I'm not trying to take anything away from him. I'm just trying to get him to maybe do some things kind of on my terms, but enjoy being with me. And yet I don't have to be wishy-washy about it. Mm-hmm. My horses behave, but they want to. They want to please me, and I want to be pleasing to them. I want them to feel like they would rather be around me than anywhere else.
So this lack of tension also worked with you as a filmmaker, it seems. You never guys, it doesn't sound like you guys had any confrontations over this process.
No. It was, and here again, not having made a film, I just didn't know if that was unusual or not, but I knew him enough and I had been around him enough to know what he was about and to know that, but it was surprising to me that he, whatever we would ask, would say, can we mic you and can you just do this? Or, I mean, we were shooting him being him, mm-hmm. but like you said, sometimes we would just want to get the angle better, so we'd ask him to repeat something. And never complained. He had a long day, and sometimes would show up with the cameras at his trailer and do interviews. And he just—it was unflappable, and that was pretty impressive. I mean, because a lot of people would just be, "I'm tired. I've had a long day. I've been working off a horse all day, talking to people all day, and not a complaint." So that inspires everyone else around that they've been working 15-hour days too. No one complained. We were all working hard. We loved what we were doing.
Does it change the rhythm of your life when you have a camera watching what you're doing anyway? I mean, you talked about the four day cycles of your life and how you're kind of done at the end of the 4 days and ready to move to the next place and enjoy that on a certain level. Is it different when you know somebody's gathering that?
Not really, no. I was just kind of being myself, you know, so. Mm-hmm. It really didn't change things much for me, you know. And it's like when I was doing the Horse Whisperer, a lot of people would say, "Well, boy, how's this going to change your life?" I said, "Well, you know what? When the Horse Whisperer is in the bargain bin at Walmart, I'm still going to be out there being me." Mm. And that's just the way things go. And yet it was very successful, and it brought a lot of attention to the style of horsemanship that I do, even though it's not like it was an instructional video, but it got people interested in my life and my teachers. So, and I really think this will more so, because there's a lot more of the real deal in this documentary mm-hmm. than there was in The Horse Whisperer, just the nature of the film. So maybe it will bring someone into this that wouldn't have otherwise seen it.
So does carrying the tag, The Horse Whisperer, "Oh, that guy's the Horse Whisperer," is
well,
not.
Well, you know, it's something that, it's not like I go around all my friends that I grew up on ranches with and say, "Hey, guess who's back, boys," you know. But that's the way a lot of folks that are sort of urban type people, that's how they identify with what I do. Mm. So I don't take offense by it. I don't go around bragging about it or anything, but that's how they sort of identify with me, so that's okay.
You don't have a convention with a dog whisperer and the...
No.
Who although, does kind know, of the same thing, it seems.
Although that guy, he's pretty squared away, that dog mm-hmm. whisperer fella, and yet he probably doesn't even realize that if not for my life and my involvement with Redford and Nick Evans, mm-hmm. he wouldn't have a show.
Probably not.
Because it really was a spin-off, you know, just yeah. they coined the term, you know, really as a spin-off from the movie. I've never met him, but I'd like to meet him sometime. I think he's a pretty squared away guy.
Well, his philosophy seems to be very similar
to
yours.
Real common sense approach to things. Yeah.
And actually, watching the movie, so did Super Nanny. It occurred to me.
Yeah.
We have a young kid, and my wife watches Super Nanny a lot. I'm like, same thing, where it's really not the kids, it's the parents.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And how they lead and don't lead that really affects the kid.
Yeah, I hate to admit that, but I actually watch that too.
The three of you should have a show together. It'd be like the greatest Oprah show ever. Uber go. Oprah episode. So what was the hardest thing of all of this for you to get done? Cindy.
Oh, you're asking me.
Yeah.
The hardest thing. The hardest thing really, I think, was editing the 300 hours of footage, because we took a lot. Because I knew that every clinic was different. You know, people think if they go to this clinic, this is what's going to happen. It's different every time. So I wanted to keep adding these jewels mm-hmm. to the footage that we had. And then we tried to put it all into a workable story that would make sense to people, where they could understand the horse part, but also understand the human part and what he's trying to teach. And
well, it seems like it kind of came down to 4 or 5 selected stories
that
have a through line of everything else, but that was kind of how you had to structure to make it work. Are there 2 or 3 more stories that you...
There's a lot more stories. We would say, oh, this is a great story, let's work with this, and we'd try it, but it... And our test screenings, I have to say, everyone just wanted more Buck and more Buck and more Buck, so we just kept whittling, and we had some wonderful people and wonderful stories, and you know, it's sad that it's not all in there, but then again, it's a movie, you kind of have to have a certain timeline, and we wanted to get it as strong as possible, and I think that we did. I think that that just people want to see Buck. I mean, he's really sort of the core of the whole film.
And you've obviously felt like it goes past the horse people, the people who are into equine life, that it's really reaches everybody else.
We test screened with mainly non-horse people, and that's how we kind of formed it, because we knew the horse stuff was there. I mean, and we were sure about
the horse people, you know, because I've been doing this 28 years now, teaching horsemanship, and the horse people were going to be on board regardless.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
But we really wanted it to appeal to people that maybe didn't have horses, but there's something about the human. There is a kinship between a lot of people and horses that don't even have horses. They have a soft spot there that's maybe goes back a long, long time. But it's surprising how it still appeals to people that maybe don't live in a place in the country where they can have livestock or any animals like that, but they still feel it.
Well, that horse that gets put down at the end is, I just kept on thinking, what a beautiful animal. Every time there was another shot across the body, it was such a unique build, but also just absolutely gorgeous.
Yeah, and what a shame is, like I was saying, drawing the parallel between raising a handicapped child, that horse was the equivalent of that. And that anybody who has been in charge of a handicapped child, it is a grave responsibility. And sometimes a handicapped child maybe doesn't have an internal editor that helps them to be able to separate right from wrong, the decisions that maybe a normal child would be able to make. And that's true with that kind of a horse, too. And if you noticed, when I was in the picture working with the horse, things were completely different. But when I wasn't there, things were completely different again.
Mm-hmm.
And so it was clear to those people that without me in the equation, it just simply wasn't going to work for him, and somebody was probably going to get killed. And what a shame, because it shouldn't have been that way with that horse. But we hear stories every week in the news about kids that went the wrong way, and immediately I just think, I wonder what the hell their parents are like. Because I don't think they're born bad. I don't think people are born bad.
No.
And I just can't think that. And you think, well, how far back could that have gone to where somebody could have said or done the right thing with that kid and they'd have been totally different? And it's the same with horses. So the parallel between horses and people is kind of scary sometimes.
Hmm. So you got a team together for post-production as well.
Mm-hmm.
And you looked at all the stories. This is how it all came together. Was it, did you tested and then changed and tested and tested?
Yeah, we did several tests because... I think we all knew when things were just like, first, the beginning was very hard because you're trying to bring people into this world and help them understand. All of a sudden you're in a clinic. Some people don't even know what a clinic is. So it's like trying to get them to understand what he does before they can understand where it's going. So that was really a trial because we had this beautiful beginning and people would see it and then they go, but we didn't know what it was about for 15 minutes. And so he's sort of like, great, but it was so beautiful. You know, it's like heart-wrenching to sort of scrap that and start over. But we were tenacious. We just kept working at it, redoing it. We'd have good stuff, but we would cut it. And because we knew it still needed to get tighter, tighter.
You were doing Buck editing.
We were doing Buck editing.
It was Buck-style editing.
Yeah, it was interesting, the beautiful helicopter shots that you got there at McGinnis Meadows. All the horse people that already understood what my life is about, they love that because it is just, it looks like out of Africa, only it's in Montana. It's just spectacular. But you're right, if you weren't sort of already in the know, it was just some beautiful scenery and beautiful horse work that they still didn't know what they were seeing. So I can see why you changed it, but a lot of the horse people didn't understand that part of it. The ones that had already seen it. But but that's the same thing that Redford dealt with on the Horse Whisperer. There was a point to where I went down to Napa Valley. He was editing right toward the tail end of it. He was just about done. And he was down to 4 hours. And he just said, I don't know what in the world I'm going to do. And he had another hour. And it was still an awful long movie.
Yeah.
But he still had an hour to cut out. And I just said, well, don't look at me, Bob. That's
yeah. He told me, he said he wanted it. He said, I wanted that to be a four-hour movie because it was very hard for him to do it, too. He still remembered that when I interviewed him.
Yeah.
So, well, it's definitely changed. Cinema has changed in the last, I think, in the last number of years, as people are trying different forms, and that and films are not necessarily, you know, an hour and a half, an hour and 45 minutes. So we're seeing filmmakers like Todd Haynes and others, great filmmakers, who've gone now to, you know, television format. If they need, you know, is doing the Mildred Pierce is coming out in a few months, and he's redone it. It was 12 hours long.
Wow.
And he felt to tell that story properly, he needed 12 hours.
Mm-hmm. Well, and then look at the documentary field in itself. 20 years ago, if you did a documentary, you better have a lot of money because they're going to play it on PBS about once, and then it's just going to disappear. Mm-hmm. And now people care about that, and they're interested in that. And I think that's really cool. It's because there's some really neat stories come out that the only way to tell the story might be in a documentary.
Mm-hmm.
And now people are interested in it. And so that's kind of neat how that's
changed.
It's the
real reality shows,
you know. That's
not
true.
A fake reality show.
Well, you have to trust the person also. Is I think that, you know, there are people who play characters in these films sometimes, much like reality television.
Mm-hmm.
But when you see something like this, there is a clear sincerity to it that is, you know, in some ways the movie is simple. You know, even though obviously it was very complicated putting it together, but there is a cleanness to it that doesn't ever make you question whether you're seeing a trumped up version of anything.
And I was shocked, honestly, because I didn't know when I put a mic on him and a camera on him. I mean, he's used to talking into a mic all day, but he doesn't allow cameras at his clinics because he doesn't want to take someone to take it out of context and just show a second and then post it on This Is Buck Brannaman. So I didn't know if we had a camera, him pouring coffee and getting up in the morning and just the basic stuff he was doing. I didn't know if he'd suddenly be, oh geez, there's a camera and looking at the camera. But he was such a pro from the beginning. And this is something I don't know if you realized I picked up on, but my voice was never heard as an interviewer. Mm-hmm. And so we would say to people, you know, it's not heard, so you need to sort of repeat the question. And he was spot on. Most people you would have to remind occasionally, like, okay, we need the question worked in. You know, you tell him something, he was a machine. He and he never looked at the camera. He never bobbled. He would always include the question. At one time, toward the end, he said an answer. And then he went, and he corrected himself before I could say anything. He said, no, let me do that over again. And he did it with the question just because.
I didn't realize I did, but I'll take your word for it.
I don't know. I thought, it's like, how does he know that? I mean, he's spot on. So it was a joy to work with him because he was the perfect, he was the perfect subject in that response as far as just the way he would react to the camera, or not react to the camera, just no reaction, just he was Buck. So what you see is what it's like, truly.
So is this the first time you saw the picture, or picture with an audience, at least?
We saw it, it wasn't really, it seemed like there was some other stuff you did to it since I saw it, but maybe not.
No,
but
we saw it in
Fort Worth a month ago, but it was on a small TV, so it was, and still it was great to see. But you know, there's nothing like seeing it on a big screen. You know, it's just just so neat to finally see it. And what was really neat is that a bunch of my friends that. Hey man, they knew me when I moved in with the Shirleys. They were here, and for the first year and a half or so, I lived with the Shirleys. I had one pair of pants I wore to school, and the other pair of pants were Betsy's, believe it or not. And if you notice, she's pretty short. So I was a little fella when I moved in with them, and I wore her old wore out pants to work in. And so those people knew me way back when, and the fact that they were here today, that was so cool.
And your daughter must have had a good time also.
Yeah, she you know, you can put her about anywhere and she just gets along fine. Yeah.
It's a nice thing to see.
Yeah.
And the audience reaction was pretty much what you expected today?
Well, I didn't know what to expect. You know, I don't live my life begging for approval or begging for applause when I'm in front of the public doing clinics. I've never been known as being real commercial or in any way whatsoever, which means I'll probably be working the rest of my life as well. But I've never been so needy that I really need that approval. You always hope that people appreciate what you're doing, but I sure don't expect it. But they seemed so so warm to us there today, mm-hmm. that I thought, gee, this is fine. You know, I was a little nervous because I do most of my work with a microphone on from the back of a horse, and then you would be on the back of your horse. Mm-hmm. And that makes it a pretty level playing field. In fact, I kind of have the edge. So it was a little bit of a different environment for me, mm-hmm. being there. But I have to say, everybody just, they really give you the feeling that they were glad to be there and that they were real happy to see us. So,
absolutely.
Yeah, it felt good.
They were happy.
Yeah.
They liked it. We were happy. We were happy because that was the goal. And that was to make a film that would raise awareness of, mm-hmm. of how you treat animals, how you treat horses, how you treat people. And I think the fact that so many people cried, and before that in the screenings, I had so many people call me up and come up to me in tears, and so I felt like I was getting to that place that I wanted people, mm-hmm. to feel it. It's what I had felt. So that was my goal, is to do this story and to spend 3 years of my life doing it. I thought I just had to capture that, and for people to come up to me in tears makes me feel like I did that. So, mm-hmm. I was thrilled. I was thrilled with the reaction, and I think that I hope it continues. I hope that other people will see the film.
Do you expect to get back on this particular horse anytime soon? Documentary filmmaking?
Well, it's interesting you ask that. there are some options in play right now, and we shall see.
So that sounds like a yes.
Not,
it doesn't sound like you're afraid of it.
Not necessarily with a horse in it, but other things I'm passionate about. And
great.
It's been an experience.